brothers and sisters, I want us to look at this. Miller studied the scripture. the secret of the Lord is with who? Those who fear him, as recorded in John chapter 16, verse 13. And so Miller studied the scriptures and was able to what? To discover the truth of the second coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And for us to be able to know all the prophecies, as the Bible says, I want to read from 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19 to 21, which says, "And so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to hear as a light that shine in a dark place until the day dawn, and the morning star rise in your hearts." Verse 20 says, "Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation." Verse 21 said, "For prophecy never came to us by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit." My brothers and my sisters and my online viewers, I want to conclude this by reading from the lesson that the symbol in the prophecies book are not locked in mystery. A loving God has given us his prophetic word to prepare us for the climatic events soon to unfold in the world. William Miller clearly understood that prophecy was its own best interpreter. The symbol of prophecy are made clear by the Bible itself. Beast represents kings and kingdoms, as recorded in Daniel chapter 7, verse 17 to 23. Wind represents destruction, Jeremiah chapter 49, verse 36. And also, we are told that water represents people or nations, as recorded in Revelation chapter 17, verse 15. A woman represents the church, Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 6, Ephesians 5, 22 to 32. My brothers and my sisters, online viewers, I want to encourage you that the time of prophecy of Daniel and Revelation also are given in symbolic languages, with one prophetic day representing one literal year, Numbers chapter 14, verse 34. Ezekiel chapter 4, verse 6. As William Miller applied this principle of biblical interpretation, he was startled at what he discovered regarding what he believed to be the timing of Christ's return. So with this, my brothers and my sisters, I want to encourage you, let us be sure that Christ's coming is sure. His return to this world is very sure and it is certain. So we need to prepare ourselves at all times. May God bless us even as we continue to search the word of God, so that we will not be found wanting. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Pastor Simon, thank you. There were some great revelations that were from this lesson. We could realize that William Miller, in the first place, was not an Adventist. He was a Baptist. He was not a pastor or a theologian. He was a farmer. And that is so startling. You did not need to be an Adventist or in a particular church before you get to know the truth, because it is the Bible that leads people to the truth. When you read from John chapter 17, it says, "When the Spirit of God comes, it will lead you into all truth." So William Miller availed himself, and the Spirit of God led him into all truth. And that was why he got to know the truth of the second coming, and he became a Seventh-day Adventist. And so we entreat all our listeners and our viewers to search through the scripture. Our individual churches may not necessarily lead us to the truth, but when you follow the Bible and its teachings, you will get to know the truth. The truth will set you free, and The truth will lead you to the right church. Maybe you are listening, you are watching, and you are contemplating on a church to attend. I do not recommend any church to you. I recommend the Bible to you. And the Bible, when you study it, it will reveal all the truth to you. And the truth will reveal a good church to you. You can worship and study with any Seventh-day Adventist church that is close to you. The Lord bless us as we listen to our dear brother Ernest. He has some great revelations to give to us. But before then, our sister Esther will want to bring us some comments from home.
Thank you so much, Pastor Isaac, all the way from Ghana. And Pastor who has just spoken, Pastor Simon, all the way from Gambia. Now, could it be true that whatever we are discussing here, because I'm also coming all the way from Kenya, could we be tricking people? Could we be tricking? No. What we are telling is true, that we should have hope that very, very soon, Jesus is doing what? Jesus is coming. Now, I want to go straight to the online, our online viewers, and then I'll try to see what they are saying. There is Lillian Ander. He's saying, Happy Sabbath, saints. Watching from Sweden, be blessed all.
Amen. Amen.
And then we also have Otachi Koch saying, Happy Sabbath, Adventists, and blessings as we worship God today.
Amen.
Then we also have Alfaxad Mogikoyo, who's saying this. The second coming of Jesus is a blessed and motivating hope because it will bring to an end all our suffering and hardships and open the doors to the faithfuls to live with and commune with God.
That is a great insight.
Thank you so much, our online viewers. We are together. Together we are learning. And indeed, for the part that our pastor has just concluded, discussing about William Miller, Pastor Isaac, I have this analogy of a person by the name Malcolm X.
Okay.
Malcolm X said this: if you want to hide something from an African, hide it in a book. But then himself, he was, as I studied more about him, he was a Pan-Africanist.
Yeah.
He was fighting for the rights of the Africans in America and even religions. So he realized that when people don't read, then they become ignorant.
Yeah.
So I want to relate this with William Miller, who took it upon himself and then made sure that he read the Bible with his pen and a notebook. And then by comparing scripture with scripture, he allowed the Bible to explain itself. Actually, that's what I get from the part of Tuesday.
Thank you, Sister Esther. Pastor Ernest will continue. Malcolm X said his own mind, but we disagree with him on this platform because not reading is actually a human problem, individual problems. Africans are reading. Seventh-day Adventists worldwide are reading and looking for the truth. Those in Africa are reading. Those in Asia are reading. Those in America are reading. And so, well, it is not an African problem because we have Africans that read very well. And that is why we have the truth also in Africa. And the church here in Africa is growing so well because we are reading and looking for the truth. Pastor Ernest, yes, you have some great revelations for us.
Okay, thank you so much. My brothers and my sister, for brilliant exposition of the lesson. So, from our brother Simon's exposition, we realize that William Miller discovered certain biblical principles for interpreting prophecies. And then as he discovered these principles, he was able to bring to the knowledge of Christians a very important doctrine or prophetic timeline in the Bible, which is the 2,300 days of Daniel chapter 8, verse 14. After reading through the entire Bible and using his concordance to explain and to understand the Bible, he observed that there were certain timeline prophecies in the Bible which were predicted by prophets which came to pass. For example, when God told Abraham in Genesis 15 verse 13 that his descendants were going to be slaves in Egypt for 400 years, it came to pass. Amen. And then when God predicted the Israelites were going to spend 40 years in the wilderness, it also happened. And then when Jeremiah also prophesied that the Israelites were going to spend 70 years in Babylon, it also happened. So William Miller was intrigued that if all these events happened, and one of them that he also discovered were the 70 weeks prophecies, which also happened. And how did he actually come to know about these 70 weeks? He got to know this by discovering the meaning of what is in Daniel chapter 8, verse 14. Daniel chapter 8, verse 14 tells us that, "And he said to me, for 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be cleansed." The context of this Daniel chapter 8 verse 14 is when Daniel had a prophetic vision of a ram which was overpowered by a he-goat. And this he-goat had a notable horn which was broken, and in place of it there were four other horns which came. And then after these four horns, we had a little horn. And we know that this prophecy, they build upon each other. So the prophecy in Daniel chapter 2 was built upon by Daniel chapter 7, the prophecy in Daniel chapter 7. And the prophecy in Daniel chapter 8 is also building upon what is in Daniel chapter 7. So when Daniel saw this vision, Angel Gabriel was able to interpret most of the things he saw. Because according to Daniel chapter 8 verse 20, Gabriel explained that the ram represented Medo-Persian kingdom and the he-goat represented the Grecian empire. And the little horn represents Papal Rome. And in the course of the little horn prophecy, that was when we get to know about the 2,300 days prophetic period. And this was the only portion in Daniel chapter 8 that the angel could not explain, because Daniel fainted in the course of the interpretation. He fainted. It wasn't easy to see all these things, so he fainted.
Wow.
And so this wasn't explained by the angel. So William Miller was able to study Daniel chapters 8 and 9 to discover a link between what was not interpreted in Daniel chapter 8 and what was explained in Daniel chapter 9. So William Miller discovered that the 2,300 days prophecy in Daniel chapter 8 verse 14 was explained in Daniel chapter 9, verses 22 down to verses 27. And from our previous lesson, we have seen that in prophecy, a day equals a year. According to Ezekiel chapter 4, verse 6, and Numbers chapter 14, verse 34, a day equals to a year. So this 2,300 days is interpreted to be 2,300 years. And so William Miller studied the Bible to discover when this 2,300 days prophecy started and when it ended and what was going to happen after it ended. So after studying Daniel chapter 9, he realized in Daniel chapter 9 verse 24 and 25. Before I read 24, let's read 25 to know the starting date for this time. It says that, "Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again and the wall, even in troublesome times." So the angel gave a clue that when a command is made for the children of Israel to go and rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, that will be the starting point of the 2,300 days prophecy. And this 2,300 days prophecy was divided into two. We had the 70 weeks, which were allotted to the Jews. That is in Daniel chapter 9, verse 24. 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. So 70 weeks are determined simply means 70 weeks are cut off. They are cut off from which? They are cut off from the 2,300 days. And so 70 weeks, converting it into days, will end up into 490 days, prophetic days, which means that 490 years. And so when you look at the verses, it was like they will finish the transgression, they will make an end. It was saying the same thing, and it will end in the anointing of the Messiah. And these 490 days, which is going to end in the anointing of the Messiah, the anointing of the Messiah simply means the baptism of Jesus Christ. The baptism of Jesus Christ. And so the starting date for these 2,300 days, we get a clue in Ezra chapter 7, verse 7 to 13, when we see the king, the Persian king Artaxerxes, giving the command for the Jews to go and rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. And according to history, the exact date is not in the Bible, but a critical study of historical document indicates that this command was given in the fall of 457 BC. So which means that the 2,300 days prophecy started in 457 BC, which also means that the 70 weeks which were cut off also started in the same date.
Yeah.
So 490 days, deducting it for the 457 BC, we know that BC years are counted downwards. It is after the AD that we count it upward. So when you count from 457 BC, you are counting 490 days, it will end us up in AD 34, when Stephen was stoned and the message of God and Christ grafted officially the Gentiles to be part of the vine. But these 490 days, the Bible gives us some details. It divided it into three. The first 1 week, which was for the building of the temple, and then the additional 62 weeks. And then we have the last 1 week. So, making it simple, even the 70 weeks is also divided into two.
Okay.
We have the 63 weeks. It's also divided into two. We have the 63 weeks and the last 1 week.
Okay.
Do you get the point? And so we are told that we have the 69 weeks and the last 1 week. The 69 weeks will convert into 483 days, 483 years, which ended in AD 27 when Christ was anointed, when Christ was baptized. So that 483 years ended in AD 27. And the Bible gave a very important comment, what was going to happen in the last 1 week of the 70 weeks. In Daniel chapter 9, verse 26, it says, "And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. Until the end of the war, desolations are determined." Here is the clue in verse 27. Listen to this place very carefully. "Then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering, and on the wing of abominations shall be one who makes desolate, even unto the consummation which is determined, is poured out on the desolate." So, the last 1 week is divided into two, 3.5 years, 3.5 years. And the Bible says, after the 3.5 years, that was when Christ was going to be crucified. And after he's crucified, there will be no need to sacrifice a lamb. There will be no need to make any sacrifice. He will bring an end to all these sacrifices. And history testifies that in AD 31, that was when Christ was crucified, which means that the 70 weeks is remaining 3.5 years. And when he had 3.5 years to AD 31, it's going to end up into AD 34. That was when the 70 weeks ended. So the 70 weeks ended in AD 34 when they stoned Stephen and the message was given to the Gentiles and the message spread throughout the world. So we are remaining the last part of the 2,300 days, which is 1,810 years. Because when you subtract 490 years from 2,300 years, we are going to get 1,810 years. And when you add that to AD 34, that's what brings us to the 1844, which is the end of the 2,300 years. And what was going to happen in 1844? The cleansing of the sanctuary. And what sanctuary was going to be cleansed? The heavenly sanctuary. We know that the earthly sanctuary was a type to the antitype, which is the heavenly sanctuary. And so, this cleansing, when we study the earthly sanctuary, it's a process. It's not just a one time. Okay. It's a process.
Yeah.
So, which means that 1844 was going to be the start of this process of the cleansing, because the earthly sanctuary was cleansed annually on the Day of Atonement, when the priest would take two goats, one for the Lord, one for Azazel, and he would transfer. Cleansing here means getting rid of sin. During the earthly sanctuary, sins were compiled in the holy place, sins were compiled. So during the Day of Atonement, that's when they pull out all those things symbolically and put it on the goat of Azazel, goat for Satan, and leave him in the wilderness for him to die. So this 1844 was the date when Christ moved from the holy place to the most holy place to start the cleansing. We should get it that the second coming is part of the cleansing. But during the early sanctuary, when the priest entered the most holy place, nobody knew when he was going to come out.
Yeah, it's true.
So what they were to do is to confess their sins. They were to go through their heart, search through their heart. When the priest came out of the most holy place and you had a sin tainting your character, you were going to die. So this is the same analogy. Christ had moved to the most holy place and has started the process of the cleansing. What we have to do is deep searching of our hearts, confessing our sins, and making sure that since we don't know when it's going to come, as our sister said, we need to be ready and stay ready so that when he comes out of the most holy place, that was when events which will lead to the second coming, like the seven last plagues and the second coming, is going to come to pass. So this timeline prophecy should caution us that God has a time for doing everything. So we need to get ready because we don't know when he is coming. Amen.
Wow, wonderful revelations. Pastor Ernest, God bless you. And you see, you speak to most of our brothers in other denominations, and they seem to suggest that the books of Revelation and that of Daniel are books, are untouchable books. And when you read from this lesson, especially from the book of Proverbs, it tells us that all the ways of God are just, right, and upright. Yeah. So the entire Bible, every word that is captured in this book, the word of God says they are all right, they are all upright. And the summary says that the symbols in the prophetic books are not locked in mystery. And so these things we are studying are not things that are limited to the Seventh-day Adventist faith. We need to make this thing so clear. This is not an Adventist truth. It is a Bible truth that should go beyond the boundaries of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. We must all get into the Bible. We must study just like William Miller. Of course, we said William Miller was a Baptist. He was a farmer. He devoted his time studying, and God revealed the entire truth to him. And so these calculations also, we will have to note that we are not calculating to know the day or the time Jesus will come. We are actually looking at these prophecies. The prophecies will guide us to know the times in which we are, so that we are not taken by surprise. It will aid us to prepare very effectively as we wait for the soon coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so basically, for our online listeners and watchers, this is the summary of our lesson, and we want to thank you for taking part in our discussion. Sister Esther, do we have some key points coming from our brothers and sisters listening to us?
Yes, indeed, Pastor. Lillian Award says, "Happy Sabbath, brethren."
All right. William, we are grateful you were listening and commenting. God bless
Lillian,
you.
Lillian Owor.
Lillian.
Yes.
Lillian, we are grateful you did contribute. All right.
That's all.
And so, brethren, for those of our brothers and sisters out there who were listening to us, we are so grateful to have you. So just like we said from the beginning of the lesson, we are encouraging you to pass by any Seventh-day Adventist church that is closer. You can request for our study guide. We call it the Sabbath School. This quarter, we are studying on the Great Controversy. And every Seventh-day Adventist church will be glad to get you a copy of the Sabbath School. And we also entreat you to worship with any Seventh-day Adventist church that is closer to you. Do well to visit us, and we are so grateful. God bless you so much. God bless you. And so we will bow our heads, and our dear sister will pray for us.
Okay, let's believe and pray. Almighty Lord, we come to you this morning. Jehovah Lord, we praise you, we honor you, we worship you because you are mighty. You are our Father, you are loving God, and you are faithful. We come to you as sinners, and we ask that you may forgive our sins. This morning, Jehovah Lord, you have come to us in spirit, and in the name of Jesus Christ, you have taught us much about the hope that we always are looking towards so that we can eventually make it to inherit the kingdom that comes. O King of Glory, as we study this book, this lesson about prophecy, Jehovah Lord, I pray that you may keep on revealing to us that which we do not know as you have done it before, to our predecessors. Jehovah Lord, we call upon you today that the lesson that we have discussed and that all that we have learned, that you may also keep on teaching us more so that this will help us to eventually make it to heaven. King of Glory, we pray for every person, all those who are in various challenges, Jehovah Lord, some are mourning and others are lack, Jehovah Lord, that you may come through for them. We surrender this great Sabbath day to you, that Jehovah Lord, you bless us through it and bless all, and so that eventually the message will reach each and everyone. We pray all this morning, trusting and believing in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Colleagues, thank you for coming. Thank you for the discussion. And our watchers, listeners, thank you for contributing. God bless you.